Okay, in this video, we're going to wrap up factor analysis, and basically what we want to do is confirm a few things and then be able to use the data in other analyses that we're going to do. Going through the process of factor analysis can actually be beneficial for a lot of things. The primary focus of doing factor analysis is to try to measure latent variables. And so that's what we want to kind of accomplish, and then operationalize the analysis by creating summated scores which represent the latent variable that you can't directly measure. Another though factor or benefit here is that you can identify the underlying things that drive maybe a latent factor. So like in regression analysis, we know what the dependent variable is and we measure it. But here in factor analysis, can think about the factor as a dependent variable. And in a way, if it's like a formative variable, particularly, but think of it kind of in reverse, or think of this idea that you can't directly measure a dependent variable, and so what you want to do is measure independent variables to form a proxy of it. So there's actually some other interpretations and use of factors that are going to be beneficial down the road. But to wrap this up, we're going to talk about summated scales and how we can do this, make use or operationalize again the factors that we have. So we want to review the factor loading matrix, or the factor score matrix, if you will, and then we want to use the factor loadings to be able to come up with a score. One note that is helpful to remember at this point in time is that if you have any reversed scored items, there'll be negative factor loadings, and you want to unreverse them if you have them in your data. You probably want to do this before now, but if you have a reversed item, an item that is has opposite anchors, then you want to create a new item that reverses that score for you. So make sure you do that, or else you're going to have problems scoring the actual data. The other issue with that is your reliabilities when you calculate Cronbach's alpha, you'll have it'll blow up on you. You won't be able to do it real well. So make sure that you handle that probably sooner. So that's that. The next item then, or to wrap this up, is to use the actual factor loadings. And actually what we do, there's a couple ways to do this. On the screen here is a structure matrix. It's actually a factor matrix then with factor loadings that from the HBAT data. And I used a Promax rotation. The textbook uses a Varimax rotation, and that was discussed earlier. But I used a Promax rotation, and this is the structure matrix here, and we have our different factor loadings. So it's clear that this first set of factor of loadings go with this first factor probably. So we're going to call this first factor, I don't know, this is something that deals with delivery and complaint and ordering orders and billing. So it's kind of the relationship of maybe delivery and final execution of the product. We have a second load factor. We have a third factor, which just has two items. And then we have our fourth factor here. Notice again, this negative. So we need to reverse code this one item so that it is going in the same direction numerically as the other items. Again, it's going to blow up when you do alpha, and it's not going to give you the correct factor loading here if we move forward with this. So what we're going to do is we will actually look at different respondents. So we have 10 different respondents here. This is just drawn from the data set. These are just 10 respondents. And this is the actual response here for each of these factor items, for each of these variables. So X12, 7, and 10. Respondent number one scored a 6, a 3.9, and a 4.8. And then for the next factor, we have responses from the survey, and then we have the next factor, and then the fourth factor. So we actually have four factors. We have, I think, 11 or so variables, and we have 10 different respondents, and this is their actual data. So what I want to do is create what we call a composite score for each factor. So what the easiest way to do this, and which is actually done fairly commonly, is to just simply average. Like, so I have 6, 3.9, 4.8. If I took the average of these three scores, I'd get 4.90. And then for respondent number two, they scored a little bit lower. They rated things lower, and their average score on those three items is a 3.07. So now what I have is an average score for each respondent on these factors. So this first factor here, we said was some type of a delivery rating type of a factor. Some of our respondents view their performance of the firm higher than others. So this is the average score on those three items. We know those three items go together because the factor loading told us they did. So this is the factor score for them. And this is just using an average factor score. So we have an average factor score for this factor. We have a new average factor score for our second, and then our third, and then our fourth. So what we have effectively done here is we've reduced our 11 variables now down to four variables, which are summated. And we call this a composite factor. And that's kind of an easy way to do this. So this is a way we use our data reduction. And now it's important here that you think about, we reduced our data from 11 to 4. So you're like, well, you're losing data when we do that. But really, we're not. I mean, we are losing a little bit in the sense that we have fewer data points. But what we're actually doing is we're averaging together items that go together. And we're canceling out some error that is existing from these variables. So this actual composite score should, if done correctly, be far more robust than any of these individual scores are at all. So it's like you're replacing three slices of the pie with the whole pie when you do a factor score. So it's actually provides a much more robust, generalized view of the data than if you didn't do this. Another method is to take a weighting of like a weighted score for each of these items. And so here is an example for just the first factor here. We had items 12, 7, and 10. So we have item 12, 7, and 10. So we have these items. Here are the original scores again, right? And we had the original factor. So this is what we had just before. This is the average factor score, right? The average score. Now, what we can do is we can take the factor loadings, which are going to be up here. Okay, we can take the factor loadings and we can create a weight that is appropriate to how strong each factor loading is within each factor. So these are the factor loadings. We have 0.965, 0.95, and 0.893. Now, the 0.893 is a little bit less influential than these others. So what we're going to do is step number one is to sum up the factor loadings. So we're going to take the sum of these factor loadings. This is step number one, okay? And the sum is going to be 2.808. The second step is to divide each loading by the sum to get a weight. So we're going to divide this the sum here by the weight, by the factor loading to get this relative weight. So 0.343 is the relative weight for this first variable, and it's the strongest. And remember, the weakest was X10 here, and so its relative weight is a little bit less. So these will sum up to 1. So if you added up these weights, they would sum up to equal 1 in this data. And now, once we have these weights, we can apply the weights to the actual score. So step number 3 is multiply the raw score by each weight for each variable. So we're going to multiply 6 times 0.343, and we're going to get this resulting weighted score for that particular variable. We're going to multiply 0.39 by 0.338, and then we'll get this weight, relative weight score, this score that's weighted. And then we'll do the same for X10 as well. So we'll take the 4.8, multiply it by 0.31. 8, and we'll get this score. Now, step number 4 is we sum up the new scores to create a weighted factor score. Now you'll see that these weighted factor scores in this example are very, very close to the average factor score. Now, the reason why is because when we put this factor together, the actual scores that resulted were very, very close to each other. If we had a variable, if we had another variable and its score was really, really low compared to these others, then we would see a bigger deviation here, a bigger difference in the weighted factor score. But as it is, again, in this example, these factor scores are pretty close to each other. So the average factor score and the weighted factor scores are going to be pretty close to each other in reality. Okay, so that's how you do a weighted factor score. And you draw, again, you draw this from the factor loadings that are returned from your analysis. In common practice, using an average is oftentimes used, but you can also deviate and use weighted factors. Different people will adopt different methods and they will swear by them. And so I just want you to know that there are different ways to create a summated score. And just depending on who you ask, you can follow their lead, or you can develop your own process as well. Okay, so this wraps up how we use factors when we want to score them in our data sets.